Coming up on TSN Sports Desk, a fabulous finale to the hockey season. It all came down to Game 7 in New York.
Brought to you by the new Gillette Sensor XL and the Gillette Series. Gillette, the best a man can get. And by Olympic. Choose from Olympic's full line of products that protect and beautify exterior wood.
Hi, everyone. Welcome again to TSN Sports Desk. I'm Brendan Connor. It was down to game number 7, the Stanley Cup Final, Tuesday night. You know, for the past couple of weeks, we have been treated to everything that hockey should be. End-to-end excitement, tough, intense hockey, and that great comeback by the Vancouver Canucks to force a game 7. And Tuesday, we were really treated when game 7 came around. And no matter what the outcome of Tuesday's game at Madison Square Garden, the Canucks postseason has to be regarded as a success. They were counted out more times than a boxer with slow hands, but they kept battling back, even against a Rangers team that was desperately looking to end a 54-year Stanley Cup drought. Here's a look at the trophy they play for, of course. The Stanley Cup would be presented Tuesday night. Some fans at Madison Square Garden very confident the 54-year curse would be over, but for those not so sure, curse fighters. Those are garlic cloves. They'll try anything to remove those spirits from the garden. Canucks get the first good chance. Pavel Bure with a shot from the boards. It's a quick one, and Richter's pad just a little bit quicker. Both teams trying to intimidate one another. Boogaboom takes a run at Courtnell here, but he also gets quite a bit of Courtnell's stick right in the face. Boogaboom with a souvenir stuck to his back right there. It was a rough night for Boogaboom, as you would see. New York then comes looking to open the scoring. Steve Larmer with a hard shot, top of the circle, but Kirk McLean, good glove save. He wouldn't be able to stop this, though, on a power play. Messier to Zubov. Zubov, great pass over here to Leach. McLean stuck out of position, and Leach with a gaping net buries it, and the Rangers strike first. They lead 1-0. Then the Canucks would dodge a bullet. Watch Sergio Mimeso get the stick up on Glenn Anderson right there. Gets it into the face of Anderson. Anderson was cut quite badly on the play, but no penalty call. That could have been 5 in a game. Pat Quinn knows his club caught a break. He knows how important the next goal will be as well. And the Rangers get it again on a power play. Zubov chips it ahead to Kovalev. Kovalev drops to the trailer. Adam Graves, boom! Adam Graves has his first goal of the series. 53 on the year. First one in the final. 2-0 New York. Physical play continued. Look at this hit by Brian Leach on Martin Jelena, who goes airborne again. Mike Richter maybe makes the save of the game right here. Cliff running at the side of the net. Actually, this is Pavel Bure after Greg Adams just missed there. Pavel Bure with some great stick handling here, goes around the net. Look at the Rangers chase him. He's holding the puck, looking to shoot. Finally jams away, and it dribbles across the crease on the goal line. What a chance. Bure knows it was a good chance, and he is frustrated on the bench afterwards. Canucks cut the lead in half early in the second period. Shorthanded Trevor Linden goes in alone and holds off Leach and chips it over Richter. What a great goal by the Canuck captain. The game is 2-1, Rangers. And the fans watching in Vancouver on the big screen come to life. They know their team is back in it. And some more bad news for Jeff Boogaboom. His leg is pinned by a Sean Antoski hit and his knee hyperextended. He goes down hard. Rangers would, again, open up a 2-goal lead. Another power play. Messier standing on the doorstep in a scramble. Pokes it in. Rangers lead the game 3-1. A little bit later, here is Richter with a huge save right there on the spin around by Didick, and then a bigger save right on the doorstep, running. Richter stacking those pads, that could have saved the day. Times Square in New York, still quiet, ready for a party. You see the sign there, it says police on alert. Canucks refuse to die early in the third on the power play. Look at them toss it around here. Courtnell calls for it, fakes a shot, over to Linden, and he buries it from the side of the net. Great passing, 3-2 Rangers, and Keenan knows his team could be in trouble. Here's another good chance for the Canucks. Jelena on the give and go with Ronning. Not enough room to sneak it by Richter, but it almost goes in off Richter. What a great play. All around, Mike Richter and the Rangers barely hanging on in the late stages, and they get a huge break later on. Look at Nathan Lafayette with a couple minutes left to go, off the goalpost, just a goalpost away. The Rangers come, and the Rangers with one slim chance left, a faceoff with 1 second left, not enough time, and the game is over. And Mark Messier lifts the cup once again. He has lifted the cup a few times as a member of the Oilers. Now he lifts it as a member of the Rangers. And they take the ceremonial skate as the Canucks sadly look on. The Rangers end the 54-year drought. They also give their coach Mike Keenan a chance to lift the cup for the first time, his fourth time in the final, first time lifting the cup and first time ever seeing Mike Keenan smile, I think. There is your final score, a great way to end the season. Too bad for the folks in Vancouver. 3-2 the final for the Rangers. Leach, Graves, Messier, the goal scorers, Trevor Linden with both for the Canucks. Brian Leach wins the Conn Smythe Trophy, more on that in just a moment. The Rangers win their fourth Stanley Cup in team history, but the first since 1940. And TSN's David Pratt reports.
For the first time in their history, the New York Rangers have won the Stanley Cup right here on their home ice at Madison Square Garden. The 54-year wait is over. The celebration has just begun.
Oh, there's no better feeling in the world, I'll tell you. It's a great feeling whenever 29 guys can get together and play well together all year, you know. And the group of guys we had really cared for each other. And I think we showed it in the end, and we came through.
I'm so happy to be a part of a Stanley Cup champion. It's a bonus being in New York here and being able to do that here. And it's great to be able to help the team achieve something like this. But the Conn Smythe, it'll be something down the road I'm sure I'll be proud of. But right now it's just a footnote.
The thing about coming here and winning the cup was all the history that has happened to the Rangers, all the bad luck that the organization has seemed to come upon. And really, it was just a lot of hurdles to overcome. And the only way that we're able to do that is to get all the right pieces in place. And I guess when you finally win a championship, you got all the right pieces in place. And you need everybody right from the top to the bottom. And we got an effort from everybody. And that's why we're able to win.
Well, it's pretty hard to describe your feelings right now. Definitely we're disappointed. You never want to lose a situation like that. But you got to look at the good points and the way we played this playoff. It was just unbelievable the way the guys came together and played together as a team. And everybody was counting us out after the Calgary series, down 3-1, and we battled back and played great hockey. And like I said, definitely we feel bad now. But we got nothing to be ashamed of. We're gonna walk out of here with our heads up.
It was an emotional game and. I think our emotion went down when we had a beat 2-0 right away. But guys work hard and we tried to come back. We made it 2-1, 3-2, but we couldn't score another one.
This is the best, simply the best. Another era.
Yeah.
Yeah, all together. Different team, different organization. Everyone had their own reasons for winning it, but the team really pulled together. We played as a team, and that's what did it. Everybody in this team did it. 30 guys.
It's just satisfying. It's something you started to try to do from ever since you were little, playing on your driveway. But more than anything, at the beginning of this year, we set out to do this, and it's here. And as slow as those final minutes ticked off, I don't want this to end ever.
I'm very proud of the guys. They really worked their tails off for the whole playoffs, and we deserve better.
It's definitely tough, I think, for... you can't explain it. You work that hard, 7 games, and you have to, when you see the other team jumping up and down and celebrating, it's probably the hardest thing to take.
I've won a sweep in the finals. I've won in five, won in five a bunch of times, I guess, and once in seven. And the fans remember the series more, the players remember it, and I think from that respect it's more rewarding because it was more of a challenge. It shows your character and shows the... having to dig in a real pressure situation like we had to.
As for the Canucks, they leave Madison Square Garden with the echoes that the Rangers had heard for so long. Maybe next year. David Pratt, TSN, New York.
All right, thank you, David. And as we mentioned, Brian Leach named the playoff MVP, and why not? 34 points to lead all playoff scorers, second best ever for a defenseman. Paul Coffey in 1985 had 37, 11 goals as well for Brian Leach. He's the first U.S.-born player to win the playoff MVP and even got a call, an excited call, they say, afterward from President Bill Clinton saying congratulations. Okay, time for a timeout here on TSN Sports Desk. When we return, we'll see what the reaction was from the streets of the Stanley Cup cities. And the news from Vancouver was not very good at all, frankly.
Closest shave. They're called microfins, and they're only on the new Gillette Sensor XL. These microfins precede the blades,
As Sensor Excel's spring-mounted blades adjust to your face, these soft, flexible fins gently stretch your skin so your beard stands up for the closest, most comfortable shave ever. Get closest. Get the new Gillette Sensor Excel.
While the instant replay took second guessing out of football, the new Sterrett Digitate takes the guesswork out of measuring. It's the world's first full-function electronic tape that instantly displays feet and inches and centimeters, and automatically adds its case length to an inside measurement. It works as a rugged standard tape, too. It'll even memorize your measurement. The new Sterrett Digitate. Measuring ain't what it used to be.
Available at Home Hardware or Acklen.
The TSN Sports Desk. The Rangers beat the Canucks in Game 7 to win the Stanley Cup. Now, much was said about the party that would take place and possibly a violent party in the streets of New York afterwards should the Rangers win the Cup. But who would have thought things would get ugly in Vancouver, most civilized possibly of all Canadian cities? It was calm enough just after the game in Vancouver, people saying, hey, we had a great year and things like that. But a couple of hours after the game on Robson Street in downtown Vancouver, things boiled over. And things got very ugly. This was the first indication that there would be some trouble as some people rocking on a van on Robson. It was still the daylight hours, so maybe an hour and a half after the game ended. And then, as things got dark, some fights broke out, a mob formed, some hydro lines came down, some windows smashed, a little bit of looting going on. Police in riot gear clashing with people in downtown Vancouver. This is not New York City, this is Vancouver. Several people hurt. The crowd eventually moved on down Robson a little more, continuing looting and fighting. There were more clashes with police. The police eventually had to chase some people away from the area they were trying to secure. There were some people left lying on the street, possibly overcome by some of the tear gas, possibly hurt in the clashes. It is not a pretty scene and something Vancouver will certainly not be very proud of. Now, by contrast, the streets of the winning city were very calm. The party in New York City was very subdued. We have some pictures from New York City as well. Again, they were more prepared for this sort of thing. People spilled out on the streets of New York City right outside Madison Square Garden in a very jubilant mood, enjoying the party they had waited 54 years to celebrate. The police, the authorities were out in full force, so they know how to deal with this sort of thing in New York City. And all in all, the crowd was very well behaved. No reports of serious incidents in New York City after the game. We'll have more hockey in store later on TSN Sports Desk as we continue our coverage of the aftermath of the big win by the Rangers for that great Stanley Cup final, game number 7. Still with hockey, another Edmonton City Council deadline with Peter Pocklington has come and gone. Tuesday, City Council there was to have received a $4 million letter of credit from Peter Pocklington concerning a new lease agreement with the Northlands Coliseum. While that letter of credit was still not in the hands of the city solicitors by the appointed deadline, City Council will again attempt to discuss the government infrastructure money on Wednesday. Even though the fate of the Edmonton Oilers remains up in the air, the future of the Philadelphia Flyers lies in the hands of an old Flyer, Bob Clark, moving back to Philadelphia as expected. Clark leaving the Florida Panthers to become the president of the Flyers. There are reports that as part of the deal, Bob Clark will become a part owner of the Philadelphia Flyers. And that will bring us to another short break here on TSN Sports Desk. We'll have the baseball story when we return, where the Montreal Expos were trying their best to pillage the Pirates.
Ahead on TSN Sports Desk, the day after as Vancouver tries to recover from a good time gone bad. While the New York Rangers curse can finally rest in peace, Bobby Clark will be flying his Philly colors once again. Ken Griffey Jr.'s on a tear as he rips another one. And later on TSN Inside Sports, some final thoughts on the final series. Everybody, I'm Jim Van Horn. Glad you're with us today. It started out as frustration because of the loss by the Canucks to the Rangers in Game 7 of the Stanley Cup Final, but very quickly, frustration turned to violence and destruction. It didn't happen in New York. It happened in Vancouver. Lisa Bowes has the complete story from the coast.
Despite the Canucks' failure to bring the Cup to the West Coast, British Columbians immediately took to the streets following the game, but this positive scene did not last into the night.
Oh!
At the start of this series, much was made about the difference between these two teams, and more specifically, the difference between these two cities. But unfortunately, after the Canucks lost Tuesday night, Vancouver became very similar to an American city.
You know, we wanted to find a place to park. We can't drive up Robson. You know, there's glass everywhere. You can smell it in the air, and, you know, my eyes are starting to water and everything. Yep.
When you throw something at a cop, what do you expect? Like, you know, they have to defend themselves.
Riot police fired tear gas in an attempt to disperse the crowd. Still, looting and vandalism went on into the early morning. Several arrests were made, the majority for breach of peace. Reportedly, close to 250 people were injured during the riots. But the consensus was that this was not the work of Canuck fans. In fact, the diehards were already heading to the airport for the arrival of their heroes.
Our fans have been great all the way through. It's been a lot of fun. I think the biggest thing I'll remember from all this is definitely the reception we've got from our fans.
I'm sad that some people downtown got a little crazy, but you know, our fans have been there every step of the way, and so they should take a sense of pride in what's happened here too.
What a great reception! I mean, they've been loyal to us for the whole playoffs, and too bad we couldn't bring it home.
Still, the Canucks did give this province its longest hockey season ever. Unfortunately, national coverage focused largely on the aftermath. But by daybreak, traces of what had happened the night before were being quickly swept away, although many lingering pieces of evidence throughout the downtown core. But one thing is certain, this was a hockey season that neither this team nor this city will soon forget.
Prior to the riot breaking out, who were down there because they were in fact trying to celebrate what they perceived to be was the success of the Canucks, and then found themselves, through no fault of their own, caught up in this melee.
These people went down expecting to celebrate, I assume, in the same way that they did on Saturday night. Unfortunately, it didn't go that way. It's very unfortunate that people do get caught up in the middle of these sorts of things. We did what we could to ensure the safety of everybody down there.
And too bad such a great story had to share the front page. Lisa Bowes, TSN, Vancouver.
There was no violence in New York City last night. The Rangers had won and the curse was exorcised. Time to party. New York Americans owner Red Dutton put the curse on the Rangers in 1942. When the Americans were forced to fold, Dutton said the Rangers would never win a cup again in his lifetime. He died in 1987. Just moments after the New York Rangers hoisted the Stanley Cup last night, thousands of fans all over the city started celebrating. But unlike last year's situation in Montreal, New Yorkers showed controlled enthusiasm as they hit the streets. Police in the Big Apple said everyone was well behaved. This morning, the city papers jumped back on the Rangers bandwagon with headlines that read, "Hockey poetry, curse closed, and the Rangers finally sip from the cup." And just think, in 76 days, training camp begins and the Rangers will try to do it all over again. Right after the game last night, New York City Mayor Rudolph Giuliani announced a parade and ceremony for the Stanley Cup champs in Manhattan on Friday. The Vancouver Canucks may be in the market for a new head coach. Pat Quinn, who is also general manager and president of the Canucks, said after last night's game, it may be time for him to step aside.
My answer was, no, I'm not going to coach, and that's an immediate sort of a thing. Dave, I don't know whether it was just a big immediate response because I was down at the loss or what it is, but it may be time. I was hired to try to build an organization, and when you're coaching, some things can slip away, yet we've made some real progress. I don't want that progress to disappear. I want us to continue to grow as an organization, and hopefully we'll be able to come to this position many more times. Only do that if attention is paid to development and to knowing the other teams and the athletes that are out there and available.
And stay tuned right after Sports Desk for TSN Inside Sports. Dave Hodge chats in depth with Pat Quinn. Lots more Stanley Cup coverage still to come. We'll take another look back at thrilling Game 7 and some other facts and figures you may not have known about.
News Friday.
Welcome back. This year's Stanley Cup final will go down as one of the best in a long time. It had all the elements from the opening game win by the Canucks to their come-from-behind heroics to force a seventh. And what a seventh game it was. This was it. One game, winner take all for Lord Stanley's Cup. Would the 54-year-old curse finally end for the Rangers? They got off to a great start. 11 minutes in, Sergei Zubov with a nice pass to Brian Leetch, and he scores his 11th of the playoffs, 1-0 New York. Just a few minutes later, Rangers on the power play. Zubov with another setup. This time, Adam Graves finishes it. His first of the series, 2-0 New York.
When you're down 2-0 after one period, it is a little tough to come back, but we worked hard and we gave ourselves every chance.
Rangers were playing the physical game as well. Great hip check by Leetch on Martin Jelena. But the Canucks refused to fold. Early in the second, Trevor Linden fights off Leetch and scores a shorthanded marker. And Vancouver is down only 2-1. Midway through the period, the Rangers restore their two-goal lead. On another power play, Marc Messier gets credit on the scramble. 3-1 Rangers.
We knew we could come back. I mean, it was just a matter of getting one and getting kind of going again. Like I said, when it was 2-1, things looked pretty good. You know, the 3-1 goal hurt.
Still, Vancouver would not go quietly. They answer with a power play goal of their own. Linden pots his second of the game, and the lead once again is down to a goal.
I wasn't nervous at all when they put it 3-2. We had control of everything, but I couldn't turn out the other way, too. You know, you never know what can happen with the Rangers.
It's tough. I mean, we were at 3-2. We really felt we could come back. We felt like we were just one chance away, one shot away.
And their one shot came late in the third. Nathan Lafayette rings one off the post from point-blank range. That's as close as they would get as the final seconds ticked away.
It's over! The Rangers win the cup! The Rangers win the cup! The curse is over! They've done it!
The Rangers win the Stanley Cup with a dramatic 3-2 victory in Game 7. And with it, exorcise the ghosts of 1940 forever.
The thing about coming here and winning the cup was all the history that has happened to the Rangers, all the bad luck that the organization has seemed to come upon. And really, it was just a lot of hurdles to overcome. And the only way that we're able to do that is to get all the right pieces in place. And I guess when you finally win a championship, you got all the right pieces in place.
It's great to be able to help the team achieve something like this, but the Conn Smythe, you know, it'll be something down the road I'm sure I'll be proud of, but right now it's just a footnote.
Just satisfying. You know, it's something you started to try to do from ever since you were little, playing on your driveway, but more than anything, at the beginning of this year, we set out to do this, and it's here, and as slow as those final minutes ticked off, I don't want this to end ever.
You know, I'm very proud of the guys. They really worked their tails off for the whole playoffs, and, you know, we deserve better.
Oh, there's no better feeling in the world, I'll tell you. It's a great feeling whenever 29 guys can get together and play well together all year, you know. And the group of guys we had really cared for each other, and I think we showed it in the end, and we came through.
In winning their first Stanley Cup since 1940, the Rangers have gone through many changes, including team presidents, general managers, coaches, captains, goalies, and, of course, games. Question now, will it be another 54 years before they win again? With the Stanley Cup champions crowned and severely hungover today, the season ends, but there are a few other tidbits you should be aware of before the final curtain is dropped. The Rangers will share a total of $1 million in prize money. The Canucks get to split $620,000, I would assume, U.S. dollars. After missing the playoffs last year, the Rangers become only the third team to rebound to win the Cup, joining the 71 Canadiens and the 91 Penguins. And over 120 countries saw last night's seventh game, including the American president, who was all alone in the White House watching the Rangers win. Right. And finally, now that the monkey is off the Rangers' backs, the Detroit Red Wings can start hearing the chants because they now own the longest championship drought in the NHL. Their last cup, 1955. The Rangers broke another jinx last night as well. Seven times over the years, fans in several cities have watched their teams take part in both the NHL and NBA championship series in the same year at nearly the same time. But while the NBA teams are 3-3 in those situations up to this year, the hockey representatives have been ice cold, as we see in this week's Nike numbers.
Since the 1956-57 season, there have been seven times in the spring that a city has had a chance at the dual championships. But not only has that feat never been accomplished, but the NHL has a futile 0-6 in those situations prior to this year. In 1957, the city of Boston watched as their Bruins lost to the Montreal Canadiens in five games, while the Boston Celtics won the NBA championship, beating the St. Louis Hawks in seven games. In 1958, the city of Boston had yet another chance to win both championships. In a rematch of the 1957 series, the Bruins again lost to the Montreal Canadiens, while the Celtics lost to the St. Louis Hawks. Both series ended in six games. 14 years later, in 1972, the city of New York had the opportunity to win both championships, but the Boston Bruins beat the Rangers in six to win the Holy Grail, while the Knicks lost to the Lakers in five games. In 1974, the people of Boston had another opportunity to win dual titles, but the Bruins dropped the series to the Philadelphia Flyers in six games. The Celtics, however, won the NBA crown in seven over the Milwaukee Bucks. 1980, the city of Philadelphia for the first time had a chance to win both titles, but lost both championship series. The New York Islanders beat the Flyers in six to take the cup, while the 76ers lost to the Lakers. In 92, the Windy City of Chicago had a turn at winning both championships, but the Blackhawks lost to Super Mario and the Penguins in four straight games, while the Bulls and Azarnas beat the Portland Trailblazers in six. Finally, in 1994, the Rangers become the first team on ice to win the Stanley Cup, when that city's NBA team is in the final as well. Now, whether the New York Knicks can hold up their end of the bargain and make it a first ever cup and crown double, only time will tell.
The Numbers, brought to you by Nike. Just do it.